Well, tonight I'm excited about the Bible study. There are so many things in the Christian life that we get bits and pieces of and we haven't quite put it together. And tonight I think that as we study the Word of God, I believe that we're going to put some things together for some of us and answer some questions that maybe you've consciously asked but not know the answer to. Or how about this? Aren't there some questions that you never asked, you never did really realize even to ask the question, but you've been confused about an area of theology or how something works with God? Well, tonight, we're going to, I think, cover some things that you're going to go, oh, look what the Bible says. And look at this. Yeah, I've kind of wondered about that. Or I wasn't wondering about it, but I was confused. And so tonight, it's my prayer that as we study tonight, as we look at this, we're looking at heaven, hell, and the end of the world. And as we look at heaven, and as we look at the reality of the Scripture, where it talks about heaven, and as we look at the reality of hell, it's important for us to be able to answer, well, what does the Bible really say about these things? Because there's all kinds of things around us. Just last night, I was in a drugstore. I was in CVS. Marcy and I were stopping by after dinner, and we were getting something. And I heard, ooh, heaven is a, you guys know, ooh, heaven is a place on earth. And who sang that?
Linda Carlisle.
Linda Carlisle. B? Yeah. B. Belinda Carlisle. Never heard of her. I know the song, but I don't know. But I'm sitting there. I was literally thinking about you all last night. I'm standing there trying to get the right vitamins or whatever. And I'm hearing this and I go, man, we're so... And then I started listening to the lyrics. And it was just, you know, this heaven for me is you. That's the idea of the love song. Heaven is a place on earth. And that's a nice sentiment and all. But when we keep hearing those kinds of things and when we keep listening to what all the culture says about these different things, we start to be confused. And so there's a lot of references to heaven and there's a lot of references to hell in our pop culture, whether in song or whether in storytelling. By storytelling, I mean movies or TV shows or whatever. You know, I constantly am amazed if I flip through Prime, all the movies that are available on Prime, or if I flip through Netflix, all the movies that are available on Netflix, and I remember when we used to have video stores, for the young people, there used to be stores where you would go, you actually had to leave your house and go down and get this thing and stick it in there. But I remember in the video stores, I just remember being amazed at how many films were made about Satan and the occult and demons and horror. I mean, all kinds of stuff that was made about that. I mean, there's a whole genre out there. And I can't imagine people that are really into that. Some of you would say, well, I'm into that genre. And I go, okay, well, this is going to be important because all of these movies and all of these stories and all of these things wind up confusing us about what we really need to see and what we really need to know. So I want to remind you tonight that this is not Sheridan Hill saying we said this. I want to remind you tonight, as we do all of the studies on heaven, hell, as we preach through many things in the life of our church, this is not Andrew Coleman saying these things. This isn't Sheridan Hill saying these things. First and foremost, the prime thing of all is that these are the things that God has said. And we want to accurately know what has God said. And so we're coming to his word tonight to see this. And there's one big, huge passage that begins. So your notes should say intermediate state. At the top, Wednesday, September the 25th, and there's a big, huge passage that is right here. And you know what? I need a couple of folks to help me out tonight that may be able to read a little bit. Chuck, would you be willing to read a little bit? And Carrie Johnson, would you be willing to read a little bit tonight? My voice is not going to make it. We're going to read about half of the passages that are available here tonight. And as we do that a little bit, I want to be able to rest my voice a little bit. So, but the first one that we're going to come to is 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 through 10, and I'll read this one. But notice here that this is kind of a pace-setting passage for us as we look at the intermediate state, what the Bible says about what happens after we die. We're often wondering, where are they? What has happened? What is going on? and this begins to deal with it a little bit. 2 Corinthians 5 says, For we know that if the tent that is our earthly home is destroyed, above the word tent, my body. It's not talking about your house. It's talking about my body. This is my tent. This is where I dwell. This is where I stay. And the word tent is very interesting. When you think of the word tent, do you think of a permanent structure? You think of something that's what? Very hopefully temporary, right? So this is my temporary tent. For we know that if the tent that is our earthly home is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this tent we groan. Can I get an amen? You ever groan? Where Gina's had huge neck problems the last 2 or 3 weeks. She's been in agony. Many of you all have fought cancer. We have pain. We groan. For we groan longing to put on our heavenly what? Dwelling. If indeed by putting it on we may not be found naked. For while we are still in this tent, we groan, being burdened. Not that we would be unclothed, but that we would be further clothed. He's saying you don't need less clothes in this. That's not the answer. No, we need the clothing, and the allusion here is to righteousness. We need further clothes so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. Beautiful statement there. This flesh that's going to die is going to get swallowed up by true eternal life. Look what it says, right in the middle. He who has prepared us for this very thing is the Pope. Is that what it says? Is your pastor. Is that what it says? Your mama. Is that what it says? No. It says, he who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who has given us the Spirit as our guarantee. So we are always of good courage. Can you underline that? So we are always of good courage. We know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we are of good courage. And by the way, the French say that all the time. The French say bon courage. Can you guys say that? Bon courage. One more time. Bon courage. They don't say good luck. Sometimes they'll say bonne chance, but a lot of times they'll say bon courage. I love that. You know, going off to climb a mountain, going off to tackle a big job, going off to do something tough. A lot of times they'll say bon courage, good courage. That's what it means, and that's it comes from this passage right here. Yes, we are of bon courage, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. So it's saying, our life now is going to matter in eternity. 2 Corinthians 5:10. So let's first of all, hit my microphone. Sorry. Let's get a definition. A definition of the intermediate state. First of all, first bullet point there is the intermediate state refers to the condition of people being people between their bodily death and their bodily resurrection. This is the intermediate state. Your body has died and it has not been raised up yet again. The scripture talks about this. It sounds like a very strange thing to people who are not Christians. They look at us and they say, you mean you believe that your body is going to die, be put in the earth, perhaps cremated, perhaps buried at sea, or perhaps let go in space, or whatever it's going to be in the days ahead? What in the world? The Bible makes very clear that God is going to bring back and raise up this physical body. This lets us know that our bodies are important to God. That's why you shouldn't harm your body. That's why you shouldn't abuse your body. Your body, some people say, well, it's just a tent. It's just a flesh. It's going to go away. Don't really matter and everything else. The Bible says that you need to be careful. God puts value on your body. He's going to raise it up again. And that he is a God that values the embodied state for us. In fact, he values it so much, he came with a body of his own. So this is all very important to us. This is between the death of your body and the resurrection of your body. Look at Revelation chapter 6, verses 9 through 11. And Colonel, can you read that?
When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the witness they had borne. They cried out with a loud voice, O sovereign God, holy and true, how long before you will judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? Then they were each given a white robe and told to rest a little longer until the number of them, of their fellow servants and their brothers, should be complete, who were to be killed as they themselves had been.
So here is a very honest look at the fact that your body is going to die, and we await this resurrected body that is going to come. Fill this in. All people possess both a body and a soul. You possess a physical body and a soul. Genesis 2:7 says, then the Lord God formed the man out of the dust of the ground. And then here's the next part. So there's the body. But, and then he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living creature. When we die, our bodies are buried. Notice what it says, Ecclesiastes 12:7. And the dust returns to the earth as it was, and the spirit returns to God. Now, this is talking about when you die, the dust of the earth, the body, the carbon that your body is made up of, is going to go back to carbon. And the spirit returns to God who gave it. Flip the page, top of page 19. When we die, our souls persist. The Bible is very clear about this, and we see it even in Stephen's stoning. Look at that. Stephen is the first Christian to be put to death for his faith in the very first days of the church. And notice what happens. And as they were stoning Stephen, he called out. Listen to what he said. Lord Jesus, receive my what?
Spirit.
He knew his body was about to be killed. But Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And falling to his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. Now, we're going to talk about what it means to fall asleep. How does the Bible use that? But it's very clear that Stephen was killed that day. His body was killed. Look at the next part here. Fill this in. One day, our bodies will be resurrected and reunited with our souls. Fill that in. Reunited. So the clear picture of Scripture. Now, I just want you to notice here. Look at all of these verses. And this is only a few. But look at all of these verses that are here. John 5, 28 through 29. Mr. Carey, will you read John 5, 28 through 29?
Do not marvel at this, for an hour is coming when all who are in the tombs will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of judgment.
So there it is. Coming out of the tombs, that's the picture. Matthew 25 says, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. Before him will be gathered all the nations, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. Look at Acts 24. Colonel, read Acts 24.
But this I confess to you, that according to the way, which they call a sect, I worship the God of our fathers, believing everything laid down by the law and written in the prophets, having a hope in God, which these men themselves accept, that there will be a resurrection of both the just and the unjust.
Okay, so there's the second time we see the word resurrection used. Underline that at the end of Acts 24. Look what it says, that there will be a resurrection both of the just and of the unjust. Everybody's getting raised back up. And some are being raised to life, and some are being raised to judgment. If we were to go on through and see all of these, you will see over and over again that statement that's right there. One day, our bodies are going to be resurrected and reunited with our souls. So this brings about some key questions, and that's where I want you to go next. Look at page 20. Some key questions about the intermediate state. These are some questions maybe you've wondered about, or maybe you haven't, but this will clear some things up. Perhaps even subconsciously. Number one, so what happens at the moment of death? We want to look at Luke chapter 23 and look what it says. This is that beautiful moment. I say beautiful, only beautiful because of here we see not only Christ taking our sins upon the cross for him, which for us, that's why we say Good Friday. Why would you say Good Friday? That's the day that Jesus is in the tomb. Why would we say Good Friday after the resurrection is a good thing? My friends, the picture is that he has laid down his life for us. And if he hadn't laid down his life for us, there would be no hope. We would be doomed in our sins. But because of that, he died for us. This is the glorious, glorious hope of us. So when I say a beautiful story of Jesus on the cross, one thief on one side, or a criminal on one side and a criminal on the other, we see what happens here. Notice this. One of the criminals who was hanged railed at him, saying, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly." See, we deserve what we're getting, for we are receiving the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong. And he said to him, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And then this important phrase, and he said to him, "Truly I say to you," circle it, "today you will be with me in paradise." Circle today. It's an immediate thing. Jesus was talking about that very day. They were all three going to die, and then we see a promise that Jesus made. So fill this in. The souls of believers immediately enter the presence of God. So this is the souls of believers, those who believe in Jesus. These are not only just believe in the existence of God, but they believe that Jesus was the Christ, that he was their hope. He was the sacrifice for their sins. So the souls of believers immediately enter the presence of God. Look at 2 Corinthians 5, 6 through 8. Chuck, go ahead and read that.
"So we are always of good courage. We know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we are of good courage, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord."
Okay, so we are in the presence of God. Look at the next part there. He says in Philippians 1:23, "I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better." So this is the idea is that when you depart, you're going to be in a better place. You're going to be not just in a better place, but you're going to be with the Lord. Look at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 22. It says, "But you have come to Mount Zion, into the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and the innumerable angels in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel." So this beautiful picture that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Look at the next part, though. The souls of unbelievers, don't miss that, unbelievers. These are the people who do not believe in Jesus as the Messiah. The souls of unbelievers immediately experience the punishment of God. And so this is very heavy for us. And this isn't Andrew Coleman saying this. This is the Bible saying this. And if you were to go through and read all of the passages that deal with that, it would last a very, very long time tonight. But look at this one from Luke chapter 16. It says, "For there was a rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen, and who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate was laid a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who desired to be fed with what fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, even the dogs came and licked his sores. The poor man died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried, and in Hades, being in torment." You see, immediately Lazarus is going to Abraham's side, who Abraham with God, and the rich man who was unconverted in his faith, who was not one who was a believer and follower of God, is immediately being in torment. "He lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham far off and Lazarus at his side. And he called out, 'Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus,'" look what it says, "'to dip the end of his finger in water and cool my tongue. For I am in anguish in this flame.' But Abraham said, 'Child, remember that you in your lifetime received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner bad things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in anguish. And besides all this, between us and you, a great chasm, it's a great gulf that is between them, a great separation, has been fixed in order that those who would pass from here to you may not be able, and none may cross from there to us. And he said to them, then I beg you, Father, talking to Abraham, then I beg you, Abraham, to send Lazarus to my father's house. For I have five brothers, so that he may warn them, lest they also come into this place of torment. But Abraham said, they have Moses and the prophets. What does that mean? They have the word of God. They have been told. It's down the street at their synagogue, he's saying. They can go and hear the truth. He says, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear. And he said, no, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent. And he said to him, if they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead. Friends, there's multiple places in the scripture where we see God show up and do great and marvelous, amazing things in front of people, and they still do not believe. I remember being at Florida State campus. There would be some street preachers that would come through, and they would preach on campus. And I remember as a young student just kind of going, oh, wow, look at this. And I would stop by and watch, and there'd be a crowd gathered around him. He would be preaching the gospel. And very often somebody would say something along the lines of, well, I would believe if God would just show up right here, right now, and do something, I would believe. And I just remember that preacher, Brother Jed, would look at him and say, no, you wouldn't. No, you wouldn't. The miracle is not what you need in this case. The miracle is the Holy Spirit working in your heart. And I'm telling you, a Savior has died, and I call upon you to believe in that. I call upon you to hear this is the God of love and the God of grace. And some of you are going to hear that and believe it, and some of you are not. And the miracle that you're looking for is not what is going to cause you to believe. So we see this reality that the first and foremost thing that we recognize is that there is a moment of death, and you're either going to pass into the presence of God or you're going to pass into the punishment of God that is throughout the scripture. Number two, what about purgatory? Purgatory is this idea that we would say comes from the Roman Catholic Church, and the Roman Catholic Church says that purgatory is the place where believers go to be further purified from sin prior to admission into heaven. Now, I would like for you to put out there to the side of number two, this is false. Write that in large phrase. This is false. I don't want you to glance at this later and go, oh yeah, we teach purgatory. We kind of, Sheridan Hills is a progressive Baptist thing, you know, or something. Look what this says, 2 Maccabees, this is from the Apocrypha, not from the New Testament. This is outside, this is extra biblical or outside of Scripture. Judas Maccabees, the leader of the Jewish forces, it says, also took a collection, and man by man, to the amount of 2,000 drachmas of silver, and sent it to Jerusalem to provide, look what it says, to provide for a sin offering. In doing this, he acted very well and honorably, taking into account the resurrection. For if he were not expecting that those who had fallen would rise again, it would have been superfluous and foolish to pray for the dead. But if he was looking to the splendid reward that is laid up for those who fall asleep in godliness, it was a holy and pious thought. Underline this, therefore he made atonement for the dead. Not talking about Jesus, but talking about Judas Maccabees. And look what it says, that they might be delivered from what? Their sin. My friends, that is patently anti-gospel. There is only one way that our sins are atoned for, and that is the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so here we see that this is based, even in its start from the Roman Catholic Church, in something that is clearly not from the true gospel. And what they would say is the penalty of venial sins, and you can write above the word venial, means pardonable. This is forgivable, as opposed to the sins that they would say are not forgivable, that it's possible to have mortal sins that cannot be forgiven. So the penalty of venial sins can be removed by, in these three things, unconditional forgiveness of God. If God just chooses to forgive, he can forgive. Contrition, that is if you're sad enough about your sin. Or works of penance. And the idea of penance is that you're making up for those sins. You're atoning through works for those sins. So you're earning your way out. Notice the next part here. Souls in purgatory, under Roman Catholic belief, would say, can be helped in the process of purification, this purgatory purification, by saints or by Christians on earth through their participation in some of the things that the Roman Catholic Church would say. If your Christian friend or your Christian son or daughter or mother or father, if these saints that are Christians do this, if they go to Mass, you can help the purification of your family member. If you say your prayers, in the idea of perhaps Hail Marys or other types of prayers that are put out by the Roman Catholic Church, or how about this next one, giving. By giving money, what would we call these? If you're giving money for your family member to get out of purgatory, what is that called? That is called an indulgence. It's the sale of indulgences. You remember this is one of the tipping point issues that set off a little German monk, made him go crazy. Made him go wonderfully passionate. The sale of indulgences by John Tetzel is one of the things that caused Martin Luther to say, that is too much. That is causing me to react. And he said, this is unbiblical. And that's one of the things that kicked off the Protestant Reformation into high gear. So not only the giving of alms or indulgences, but also good works. That they would say that your good works will overcome the sins and the impurity of your family members or of your friends that are in purgatory. Now, I can say to you that we lived in Europe, and we would be traveling along in the countryside in Europe, and there would be times when we would see this beautiful little tiny chapel. Just a little tiny chapel, maybe as big as this section right here, out in a countryside at the edge of a meadow. And there were times when we even stopped and we would go up to them and we would say, this is so cool. They got a little church out here in the middle of nowhere. I mean, just you could go in here and pray and spend time with the Lord. And then you would see a huge plaque very often. And the plaque would say something along the lines that, this is Robert McElroy's chapel built for the sins or the purification of his son, Daniel. Daniel was killed in World War I, and so Robert built this chapel for Daniel's benefit. So this is talking about good works. This is talking about acts that are done by someone here to get someone. So this church was built for the glory of God. And it was built in the name of this family member. Friends, that was very, very prominent throughout Europe and throughout Catholicism. Simply, let's look here and see. Decree of the Union of Council of Florence. And by the way, these councils are seen as authoritative on par with the Bible in the Roman Catholic Church. That's one of the big issues that we would declare the difference. As Protestant Baptists, we would say the only authority that we have is the Word of God. Roman Catholics would say, well, we have the Bible, but we also have the councils, and we also have the traditions of the church, and we also have the Pope. And so these other things are where we get our authority from. And so notice what this council said, which they would see as authoritative as the Bible. Souls are cleansed by purgatorial pains after death. So this is saying you're in purgatory, you're in pain, and that pain, you're paying it off. And in order that they may be rescued from these pains, they are benefited by the suffrages of the living faith. So those who are alive can go through self-sacrifice of some form or another to help the others. So therefore, the sacrifice of the Mass, the prayers, circle it, alms. What are alms? That's financial gifts, right? The alms. And look what it says there, other works of piety. And so that's where we get those four bullet points there, Mass, prayers, giving, and good works. That comes straight out of the Council of Florence. Now, look at the top of page 22. This is not what the Roman Catholic Church says. This is what the Scripture says. And so I hope that you line up with Scripture. Circle in big right there at the top, according to Scripture. So this is very important for us. The Scripture is what tells us. Here's what the Bible says about how we are delivered from our sin. We are saved from our sins by grace alone, through faith alone. Keep going down. In what? In Christ alone. Now, there's three of what we call the solas, or the onlys, or the alones of the Reformation. Here we see that it's very clear that it is by grace alone that we are saved. Can we all read these verses right here? Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. Let's read it. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so no one may boast. Circle the word grace right up there. For by grace you have been saved through faith. Now look at the next part there, through faith. Now this is Galatians 3, and I have already underlined some of this so you can just kind of enjoy it. But Paul is making a huge point here. And one of the huge points that has to do with this whole passage is the fact that it's by faith and not by works. And you just got to get this. Look how strong he is. We don't see this kind of talk in Philippians. Philippians is such a love letter. And Galatians, he's having to straighten them out. Look what he says there. Oh, foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? It was before your eyes that Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed and crucified. Let me ask you only this. Did you receive the Spirit, look what it says, by works of the law, but the things that you did, or by hearing with faith? Are you so foolish? Having begun by the Spirit, you are now being perfected by the flesh, your hard work, all your fleshly works, you're going to be perfected by that? Did you suffer so many things in vain, if indeed it was in vain? Does he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you do so by works of the law or by hearing with faith? Just as Abraham believed God and it was counted unto him righteousness. You see, Abraham's righteousness came from believing upon God and believing in what God had said. Look what it says in the next part. Know then that it is those of faith who are the sons of Abraham. Those of faith. That's the idea. You have to believe in what God has done. In the Scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, so the non-Jews by faith, preached the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, In you shall all the nations be blessed. So then, those who are of faith, like Abraham, are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. Look at the next part. For all who rely on works of the law are under the curse, for it is written, cursed be everyone who does not abide by all the things written in the book of the law and do them. Now here's the idea. This is a very important concept. That statement right there, look what it says. Cursed be everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law and do them. Do you know that the Ten Commandments and all of the law given to us in the Old Testament was given to us in order for us to see that we are sinful? There's nobody that can keep the Ten Commandments. There's nobody who can keep the law. You're gonna blow it. And part of the giving of the law was to show us how holy God is and how unholy we are. Now, this could be really helpful to you in your theology as a Christian. Some of you are wondering, well, why were we given that? Aren't we supposed to keep the... Oh, yes, the Ten Commandments are the righteous call of God. And we as Christians should absolutely seek to keep the Ten Commandments. But let me tell you that the Ten Commandments were given so that we might see that we are not holy and God is. And he said, I will send you one who will make you holy. And so the Ten Commandments are showing us the holiness of God. And all of the law is showing us the holiness of God. And here it says, for all, look what it says, for all who rely on the works of the law are under the curse, for it is written, cursed be everyone who does not abide by all the things written in the book of the law and do them. And that's no one. There is none righteous. No, not one. Now, it is evident that no one is justified before God by the law, for the righteous shall live by faith. Faith in what? But the law is not of faith. Rather, the one who does them shall live by them. Christ, here's very important, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hanged on a tree. That comes from Deuteronomy. So that in Christ Jesus, look at this, the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles, so that we might receive the promised Spirit, what? Through faith. And so it's this thing of trusting and believing in what God has done to save us rather than trusting in our own work. So this is by faith that we receive the truth of God. And by grace, through faith in Christ. This is what we have trust in. Faith not in ourselves, faith not in our mother, faith not in our church, faith not in somebody else, but faith in Christ. This is how we are saved. Look what it says. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 5 through 6. Chuck, can you read 1 Timothy 2, 5 through 6?
For there is one God, and there is one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, which is the testimony given at the proper time.
Okay, so purgatory, I want you to get this as he wires me up. Purgatory does this. Purgatory implies that Christ's death is not sufficient. Purgatory says that Jesus' death was not enough to really make you pure. You got to go pay for some of it yourself. That is a very, very anti-gospel message. That goes right back to the works of the law. That goes right back to saying that you're going to be saved in part or in whole by what you do and not by what Christ has done. So we just want to make very, very clear that according to Scripture, we are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. Okay, so what about another issue here? What about soul sleep? How many of you have ever heard the term soul sleep? Anybody ever heard the term soul sleep? Most of us haven't really heard that, but it is a doctrinal idea that has kind of made its way around over the last 2,000 years at different points in history. The idea that, well, when you die, notice this, according to some, here's what some people would say, believers who die enter into a state, underline it, of unconscious existence. And they stay unconscious, underline that, they stay unconscious until Christ returns and raises them to eternal life. So this would be talking about believers. This would be talking about people who believe in Jesus Christ as the Messiah for our sins, would say, well, we know what happens. We're trying to make all of the timing work out here. What about the coming judgment? What about the things that are yet to happen that have been prophesied in Scripture? Well, it must mean that you go into soul sleep. Like just this last week, or 2 weeks ago, Marcy and I were at a cemetery in Miami. I think I shared with you all that I went and I saw my grandparents' gravestones. And I remember that they were both buried there in North Miami. And, you know, I remember as a child thinking about different other family members that are right there in the area. In fact, one of the first ones that I'd ever gone to a cemetery burial before, one of them was buried right there by my grandfather, my grandfather's sister, so my great aunt. And I remember just thinking, is Aunt Ruth in the ground? Is Aunt Ruth going to wait in this tomb? Is she here? It wasn't until many years later that I started to see these things as I studied the Bible more and realized that, no, there's not something called soul sleep. But let's look at this. Look at fundamental beliefs from Seventh-day Adventists who believe in soul sleep. They say the condition of man in death is one of unconsciousness, and all men, good and evil alike, remain in the grave from death to the resurrection. So even their soul is remaining in the grave. Now, after all, Jesus did talk about, describe death as sleep. Fill that in. We cannot deny that one bit, and we would say absolutely not. He did talk about this. Look at Matthew chapter 9, verse 24. He said, go away, for the girl is not dead but sleeping, and they all laughed at him. This is when a little girl died, and Jesus was going to raise her up from the dead. And they said, what are you talking about? She's dead. And in fact, they were so sure that she was dead that they were laughing at Jesus as he said that. But they just didn't realize that this is the one who can look at a little girl that is dead and say, live. And she lives. This was all a showing of who Jesus is and his power over death. And so notice here with me, Acts 7, verse 20, falling to his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. So this is the writer of Acts talking about Stephen. We already read that earlier. He was stoned to death and he fell asleep. This is talking about a temporary death. This is talking about a temporary death. Acts chapter 13, verse 36. For David, after he had served the purpose of God in his own generation, fell asleep and was laid with his fathers and saw corruption. Now, what does that mean? That means his body rotted. Saw corruption, the corruption of the flesh. So, David, there's no doubt that the word sleep here is talking about physical death. We're comfortable with that. We can say that's clearly the way that Jesus termed that, even the writer of the book of Acts. But according to Scripture, fill this in, sleep is clearly a metaphor. It is a metaphor intended to depict the temporary, underline the word temporary, the temporary nature of death for Christians. So we're talking about this in the idea of Christians, within the context of Christians, and it is a metaphor. And why? Because physical death is not a permanent thing for those who are in Christ Jesus. Look at John chapter 11, verses 11 through 13. Carrie, can you read John 11, 11 through 13?
After saying these things, he said to them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to awaken him. The disciples said to him, Lord, if he has fallen asleep, will he recover? Now, Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought that he meant taking a rest in sleep.
So here it is directly dealt with where we see Jesus is using it as a metaphor. The Scripture is explaining it. And the picture is that Jesus looks even at your physical death, and he says, in me, this is temporary. Your body is temporarily dead. My Aunt Ruth, a great Christian woman, temporarily, her body is in the tomb. Look at Psalm 115, verse 17 through 18. It says, the dead do not praise the Lord, nor do any who go down into silence, but we will bless the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. Praise the Lord. Now, this is talking about the dead as in those who are not with God. They do not praise the Lord now, and they will not ever praise the Lord. But we, as believers in God, praise the Lord all forever. Whether we are alive in the physical body or whether we are dead in the physical body, we praise the Lord at all times. So the believer continues in that. Look what the next statement there is. Believers in heaven are clearly seen not sleeping. So it's not like when you die, you go to heaven and sleep. No, the Bible says that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And what are believers doing in heaven? Notice here in Matthew chapter 17, verses 1 through 3. And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up to a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them, who? Moses and Elijah talking with him. Moses and Elijah, though they had died, in Moses' case, 1,500 years before, Moses' soul was alive, even though his body had died and been left just outside the promised land. Look at Luke chapter 23, verse 43. It says, and he said to them, truly I say to you, circle it, today you will be with me in paradise. Who did he say that to? The believing criminal, right? The criminal who believed in him. And so this picture is that even though he dies, is asleep, he's not going to be asleep. He's going to be alive with Jesus in paradise. Let's go on to number four. Here's another question. What are believers doing in the intermediate state? So my Aunt Ruth, what is my Aunt Ruth doing in the intermediate state? First of all, they are worshiping. The first thing that we see that they're doing is worshiping. And we can see many places in Scripture where it's talking about those who have gone before us, including Hebrews chapter 12 and Revelation chapter 19. They are worshiping God in the presence of God. Number two, they are watching. And this is a very interesting one for me, and I've been pondering about this for the last couple of days, so I've been really thinking about this. I wonder what all they can see. I wonder what all they watch. I do not know. But look at Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 1. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Now, as we read this, we start to see that this is talking about the cloud of witnesses that have gone on before us. What about Luke chapter 15, verse 7? Just so I tell you that there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Here's the idea. There are people rejoicing in heaven when someone gets saved. It's not talking merely about the angels, but we see that they are rejoicing. And these, who is rejoicing? Those that are in heaven. We know that the angels rejoice, but we also see that God's people rejoice. Look at Revelation 18:20. Rejoice over her, O heaven, and you saints and apostles and prophets, for God has given judgment for you against her. And this is all part of the picture of God's calling us and saving us and bringing us to heaven and the rejoicing that is in heaven even now. So they're worshiping, they're watching, and they are waiting. They are waiting for the final judgment. They are waiting for all things to finally be finished. They're waiting till death and physical death is over, and this is fully realized, the salvation that there is in God. There's a bunch of other things that they're doing, and you see the list here, fill in the top one there. They are clearly conscious. If you read all of these accounts, you'll see that those who are in heaven are not asleep, but they're conscious. And especially in Revelation 6, if you go through Revelation 6, you see all this. They are audibly loud, so they're shouting to the Lord. They are emotionally passionate. They are pouring out, and they are crying out. They are distinctly individual. There are individuals that are there. We even see that in Moses and Elijah and everything. It's not like they're just brought into some huge collective. They are the same individuals. They are completely unified. So in one voice, they are crying out very often, and they are unified in their praise of God. They are continually interceding. And so here they are crying out, even on our behalf, in this idea. They thirst for final justice. They long for full redemption. They know God's character more deeply because they are there seeing who he is and what he's done, and all things are known as they know as all things are known. They love God's church more fully. So they love the bride of Christ from which they came, that they were a part of. They are trusting God's promises in the present. And they are anticipating, keyword, they are anticipating God's plan for the future. So they await with an eager hope for the final things. Look at Revelation chapter 7 and verse 9 through 10. And Chuck, can you read Revelation 7, 9 and 10?
After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb."
So there's this beautiful picture that they are rejoicing audibly and very involved in what all is happening here. Number five, this is another question that we may have. How then should we view our own death in light of these things? Well, there's two options. The first one is all who follow Christ should anticipate death with confidence. You should anticipate. You should look at, you say, what does anticipate mean? It does mean look forward, right? So the question is, do you look forward to death? We said it last week. You know, heard the guy say, "Well, I don't mind dying, I just don't want to be there when it happens." You know, this just don't want to be around when this occurs. And I understand that. And I mean, nobody wants to die a painful death or go through this part of the journey. But we know what is on the other side if we are in Christ and we know what the Bible says. And what is on the other side is much better than what's on this side. And we have to recognize that. Now, we're teaching this because we hope that you will be an educated Christian about what God has said to you. It's not just about what the Bible says in that sense. That's a little bit far removed. What I want you to recognize is that God has made these promises to you. And they apply to you in your life. They apply to your coming death. And if you are a follower and believer in Jesus, this anticipation with confidence is for you. You say, "Well, I'm not sure I really feel that way. I'm not sure." There may be a question of whether or not you truly have a relationship with Jesus. And this is why we would call you to know that you know that you know that Christ is yours and that you are his. And if you have any question about that, I hope that you will go to a friend tonight, or that you'll email somebody when you get home, or you'll text somebody and say, "I need to meet with you. I need to talk about it. I don't know that I know that I know that Jesus is my Savior." And that, maybe that's the reason God brought you to Sheridan Hills. Maybe that's the reason that you're here, is that we are clearly saying to you, the Bible tells you that you can know that, and we want to help you work through that. The Bible tells us that that is not automatic, that it is dependent upon our belief in Jesus. And that's not just, "I believe that he exists like George Washington existed or Abraham Lincoln existed." No, it's that I am staking my eternity on what he did. I really believe in who he is and what he did. And my hope is in him, not in me. We'd love to talk to you about that. You need to work that out. And if you have a great fear of death, it may be an indicator that you need to work out assurance of your salvation. Nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that. We've had many people in many different ages come to us and say, "Hey, I really need to meet with you. I really need to talk about this. Pastor Lucas and I and Tommy and others, Edward and Alex, there's many of us in the church that we would love, there's ladies in the church that would love to sit down and say, okay, well, let's talk about what you believe. Let's talk about what your experience has been. Let's talk about where your heart is." We'd love to help you assess. You know, that's one of the reasons for church membership. One of the reasons for church membership is to help you figure out whether you know the Lord. That other people can help you assess, that the body of Christ can help you assess whether or not your life seems to be a life living in faith in Jesus. This is why when someone starts to live in such a way, to either say things that they believe or do not believe, or they start to live in such a way that does not reflect Christ, that church membership might be removed. Because we're going, wait a minute, brother, you say that you believe in Jesus, but you're not acting like one who believes in Jesus. And we are doing you a disservice if we say that we continue to believe that you know the Lord, because you're proving that you don't. You see that? So church membership is a powerful thing in helping people be either confirmed or not converted. And the idea, if you remove somebody from membership and you start to say, hey, brother, you're saying that you deny that Jesus is the only hope, you're denying who Christ is, or by your life you're denying who he is, by your morality, what we would be saying is that we withdraw that assurance from our perspective in order for you to realize that you may not be a Christian. You see, that's a very loving thing to do. It's not a, oh, you messed up. You know, we're gonna whip you now. We're gonna church you. You know, whatever. I heard that phrase one time. The guy got churched. You know, what does that mean? The picture is that that would happen in love, so that that person may realize. And there are people who wind up coming back to the gospel precisely because the church was saying, we are very concerned about what we see. Does this make sense? That's not even what this lesson is fully about, but that's a side issue here that is so important. If you cannot anticipate death, if even through this, after you think about this, you're still struggling with anticipating death and being confident of what's on the other side, it may mean that we just need to pray with you and talk with you and visit with you about the assurance of your salvation or about where you are in your relationship with the Lord. I don't know how to be more gentle and loving in challenging you with that. But look what it says in Psalm 23, verse 4, from the beautiful Psalm 23. Look what it says there underneath number 5. All who follow Christ should anticipate death with confidence. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of what?
Death.
Of death. I walk through death. I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, look what it says, they comfort me. So I am your sheep, you are my shepherd, and you are capable of bringing me through death. Look at Romans 8, 37 through 39. This is one of the most glorious passages. Mr. Carey, can you read Romans 8, 37 through 39? Man, you talk about confidence.
No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor heights, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Man, that'll help you look forward to saying, bring it on. I'm ready to roll, ready to be finally with the Lord. But now, look at this. So that's for all who follow Christ can anticipate death with confidence. But all who do not follow Christ, page 26, all who do not follow Christ should fear death with trepidation. What does trepidation mean? It means great concern. So again, we see this picture of the rich man in Luke chapter 16, that passage is just below this. This is the picture of this man over and over again. It's talking about the torment of his condition. And he is crying out. I mean, this is a guy who's just saying, just a drop on my tongue. Friends, I'm sorry, but the Bible makes so very clear to be separated from the righteousness of God is to endure the wrath of God. And so we should fear death. Look at the next part here. Another question. Question number six is, how should we view the death of others? So we've just talked about number five. How should we view our own death? And if you're a Christian, you can anticipate it. If you're not a Christian, you really should fear it. But number six, how should we view the death of others? And Dr. Russell Moore says this, at a funeral, the church is perhaps at its most theological. Now, I'm going to throw open the floor here for a second, and I'm going to ask you, what is Dr. Russell Moore saying here? What does that mean? What does that mean? At a funeral, the church is perhaps at its most theological. Who'd like to take a stab at what is he getting at? What is he trying to say? Okay, you have to speak up, Alex. Oh, Tony, I'm sorry. I've got a bright light over me. Where's Alex? I'm sorry. Okay, you can tell people the truth at a funeral, yes. And we certainly should do that. One of the ladies here today or this week said, Pastor, you're going to do my funeral. And when you do my funeral, I want you to preach the gospel. I want it to be very clear because there's going to be all these people at the funeral, and I want them to hear, I'm not there, I'm with him. I mean, she had good theology on that. But that we can do that. But I think Russell Moore is saying even something a little bit broader than that. What else is he saying here? Patrick? Okay, so a funeral is a great time to teach about that because of the reality of death and our are there. I would think that that's part of what he's saying. Rob? Bob? I think that's kind of the idea. I think what Dr. Moore is saying, let's look at it again. He's saying, at a funeral, the church is perhaps at its most theological. Here's the deal. All of your Christianity doesn't matter if what happens to you after you die is that you either go to hell or you just go out. Christianity doesn't matter if what happens at a funeral, that there is not hope for those in Christ. The picture is that everything that we believe comes down to what happens after we live this life, ultimately in Christ, that we are saved from our sins. This is a huge point. It is a beautiful picture that, man, our beliefs and our Christianity is beyond this life, and it all points to the eternity that has come. And I believe that that's what Dr. Moore is trying to say in that. Everything we believe hinges on the reality beyond the grave. So, letter A, how should we view death of others? Letter A, how should we view the death of non-Christians? So when we have someone who has died, and I know that this in some ways can be a very, very difficult thing for us, and it should be, but we need to approach this, first of all, with biblical honesty. We really need to approach this with biblical honesty, maybe personally, and maybe even corporately, or even in conversation. Here's what this is getting at here. When I was in seminary, I remember there were professors saying, you know, it's a sad thing when Christians at funerals of people who are clearly not Christians preach them into heaven. Have you ever heard that phrase? Preach them into heaven. And the idea is you're looking at a guy here or a gal who has never embraced the life of Christ and what Christ has done. And we're talking about the few good things that maybe were redemptive about their life, and we are declaring them at home with the Lord. That is very dishonest. I learned early on at funerals of non-Christians, I avoid this very much by talking about life in Christ and preach the gospel to the living. instead of trying to preach the dead into the living. I appreciate their life. I rejoice in the fact that they were an encouragement or a blessing in some way, maybe a good father or maybe a good mother or something along those lines. But I do not seek to provide some type of false comfort that is dishonest. Instead, when it comes to the gospel, I seek to make the gospel very clear and loving. So one of the first things that we need to do is be biblically honest. Another thing that we need to do is we need to approach it with personal humility. We don't gloat in a Christian's salvation and a non-Christian's condemnation. We don't say that pridefully, and we don't throw that around. Look at Luke chapter 23, verse 43. And he said to them, "Truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." Jesus is focusing on the saved man in this case and does not declare a condemnation at that moment at a man who is about to be lost in eternity. Look at the next one here. He does so with appropriate honor. We should deal with those with honor that do not know the Lord. And we can do that. And we see this example in 2 Samuel of Saul's death and how death Saul's in his death was still honored by those around him, even though he was a wicked king. Look at the next part here. We should approach it with heartbreaking anguish. When we think about the death of a non-Christian, it really should break our hearts. And it should not only break our hearts for them, but it should break our hearts for those that are around us. Look at Romans chapter 9, verses 1 through 3. "I am speaking the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience bears witness in the Holy Spirit that I have," look what it says and underline this, "that I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart." And he's talking about those who do not believe. "For I could wish that I myself were cursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my brothers, my kinsmen, according to the flesh." Not only should we have anguish about those who do not know the Lord, but we should approach it with life-giving resolve. And this means that we should say, you know, I'm going to live my life so that people can come to know Jesus. Missionary Jim Elliott, just beautiful statement here. You can read that tonight before you go to bed about his passion that people would come to know Christ. Letter B, how should we view the death of Christians? So this is not when a non-Christian dies, but this is when a Christian dies. How should we view the death of Christians? Well, with profound sorrow. You know, no one rejoices even in a Christian's death in some ways. Look at Jesus' statement when Lazarus died. Lazarus was his beloved friend, and Jesus wept. Shortest verse in the Bible, perhaps one of the most profound. John chapter 11, verse 35. Jesus wept. He had sorrow. Well, did he have sorrow over Lazarus? Did he have sorrow over unbelief? I believe that he had sorrow. I mean, we don't glibly look at, oh, well, Aunt Ruth is dead. Praise the Lord. She's in heaven now. I don't know if that's necessary. Aunt Ruth was a wonderful mother, a wonderful grandmother. I mean, we miss her. When I think about my grandmother, I miss my grandmother. There are sometimes when I still think about how I'd love to ask grandmother that. I have often thought that about any four of my grandparents who are all in heaven now. I've often had the thought of, I could ask granddad what happened at that event. And then I come to realize, no, in sorrow, I'm separated from them. We should be profoundly sorrow for that. But we can also approach it in the middle of page 28 with abiding joy. Abiding joy. we rejoice. And it's a joy that stays with us. Look at John 16, verses 23 through 24. Look what it says. Truly, truly, I say to you, you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice. You will be sorrowful, but your sorrow, look what it says, underline this, but your sorrow will turn into joy. When a woman is giving birth, she has sorrow because her hour has come. But when she has delivered the baby, she no longer remembers the anguish for the joy that a human being has been born into the world. So also, you have sorrow now. But I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you. In that day, you will ask nothing of me. Truly, truly, I say to you, whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he will give to you. Until now, you have asked nothing of my name. Ask, and you will receive, underline it, that your joy may be full. And this is ultimately talking about life in Christ. Look at John 16:33, just a few verses later. He says, I have said these things that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulations, but take heart. I have overcome the world. You see, we can be joyful because of that. And in fact, in Psalm 116, verse 15, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Over to the last page, I want you to see a statement from Aristides. Aristides was an apologist in Macedon, or in the area around Philippi in 125 AD. So probably about 60 years after the Philippian letter was written. Notice what it says here. Aristides said this, if any righteous man among the Christians passes from this world, they rejoice and offer thanks to God. And they escort his body with songs and thanksgiving as if he were setting out from one place to another nearby. Kind of a beautiful picture of this hope that Christians were showing in the ancient world. That, man, they know that they're leaving. And this is many dying under persecution. Well, how else should we view the death of saints that we love? Well, with sincere worship. What should we do with their death? We should worship God. Put out there to the side, David worshiped the Lord when his son died. Job worshiped the Lord when his children died. We're not talking about joyful, necessarily, exaltation, but we're talking remembering that God is God, and remember that he indeed is in control of all things and trusting in his hand. Here we see both of those examples in David and Samuel, or Samuel and in Job. But finally tonight, I want us to see 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 13 through 18. And I want to read this, and I want you to see this, and this is what we'll close with tonight. Very important passage in 1 Thessalonians. Look what it says. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. Let us encourage one another with these words. We have unshakable hope. We have unshakable hope in the Lord Jesus Christ. He has made promise after promise after promise. The body is going to be raised to join the soul that is already in the presence of God. Of the Lord. Now, I don't know what all that means. I don't know all of the details of those brothers and sisters who are in Christ right now in the heavens, but I do know that the Bible says, number one, you're not in soul sleep. The Bible says you're never separated from the Lord. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, that his promises are true, and we can rejoice in that. Amen. Let's stand together.